as many people are facing problems because of these fires, may they find hope in you. And this morning, as we come together to worship you and to study your word and to hear from you, Lord, it is our prayer that you will speak to us through your word. Stand before me, Lord, I give you my heart. Speak through me that your children this morning may hear your voice and not my voice, and that they may see your face and not my face. We thank you for Jesus because we pray in his name. Amen. Check, 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 check. Okay. All right. So the title of our message that I've prepared for this morning is Living Hope. You know, our culture resounds with appeals to hope. We hear every day of investment opportunities that will allow us to retire in financial comfort, or we hear of products or technology that would make our lives easier or more exciting. But you know, the hopes that this world can offer us, at best, they are just distractions from the hope that God wants to offer to us. According to Merriam-Webster Dictionary, hope is defined... Okay, I hope I will not go through this problem again of my remote control not working. Okay, there we go. So according to Merriam-Webster Dictionary, hope is defined as a desire with expectation of obtainment, to expect with confidence, or to trust. So when you expect something with the confidence in knowing that I am going to get this, I'm going to receive this, see, there are expectations that leads us to disappointments. But hope is expectation with confidence. So this morning, I want to study with you from the Bible of the kind of hope that God wants to give to us, that God offers to us, the kind of hope that we can expect with confidence, kind of hope that is called living hope. Not any kind of hope, but living hope. And we will look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 to 6. Peter writes, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, or in the last days." So the context of the letter that Peter is writing to is the first century Christians who were being persecuted for their faith. The Roman Empire was very harsh upon the Christians during those days. So as a result of those persecutions, Christians had to flee. Many Christians had to flee from the city of Rome to other parts of Asia. They were all scattered across Asia to different parts of this the empire. And so Peter is writing to those Christians who were fleeing for their lives. So in that context, put yourself in the shoes of those Christians who were running away for their lives. When everything that they had relied upon is shaken off and they could no longer depend on the government because the government was persecuting them. Their livelihoods were being destroyed. They lost their jobs and now they have to run away to different parts of the empire where they can feel safe again. Put yourself in that place, in that shoes of those people, those Christians. Now, you can understand that they needed hope more than anything else. And it is to that group that Peter is writing, saying, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." First of all, Peter starts with praising God for his faithfulness. Praising God for who he is. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to" what? "A living hope." This was the invitation or the encouragement of Peter to the Christians who were running away for their lives. He's telling them, because of God, because of who he is, because of Jesus Christ, according to his abundant mercy, God has begotten us again and he has given to us living hope. Regardless of what you may be experiencing right now from the government or from your friends or from your job or the challenges that you may be facing in your families, God has given to us a living hope. That is what Peter is saying. So this morning I want to share with you three main key points on the basis of this living hope that God has given to us. So according to this text and from the Bible, key point number one, living hope, key point number one is this: the basis of our hope lies not in our own perfection or righteousness. First of all, key point number one, if you want to write this down. The basis of our hope lies not in our own perfection or our own righteousness. Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." In some ways, if this is where things end, it is kind of depressing, don't you think? To know that our own righteousness are just like filthy rags before God, according to the Bible. The good deeds that I do, the good deeds that I perform, the good habits that I have cultivated are just filthy rags before God. None of us have righteousness on our own because we have fallen short. Humanity as a whole has fallen short of the glory of God. You don't have to choose to be a sinner. I don't have to choose to be a sinner. The fact that we come into this world automatically qualifies us and gives us the identity of being lost. First and foremost, the basis of our hope lies not in our own righteousness or our own perfection, because all have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. But the good news is this: the story doesn't end there. So according to Peter, what does he say here? "Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to" what? "His abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope." So key point number two is the basis of our hope lies in the abundance of God's mercy. Amen. Amen? Key point number one, the basis of our hope lies not in ourselves. Key point number two, the basis of our hope lies in the abundance of God's mercy. How do we know this? We know this because God has shown his love to us. Romans 5 verse 6 and 8. 6 to 8. Go with me to your Bible. Romans chapter 5 verse 6 to 8. "For when we were still without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Amen. God demonstrates his love for us. How? By the fact that Christ died for us while we were still sinners. Meaning, God loved us first before we even get to know his love, or before we even respond in love. God first loved us. If you are a parent, I'm sure you can understand this, right? Before your child ever had an idea of love, you have already loved your child. Before we ever come to know the idea of love, our parents have already loved us. And most of all, God has already loved us before we even knew it. I spent 2 years of high school in India, and I still remember this. It was in my ninth grade. I went to this school in the state called Meghalaya in northeast India. And one day, you know, ninth grade, is there any ninth grade students here among our youth? Nixie, okay, all right. Nixie is in ninth grade. So I was about that age, you know, that age where you're starting to experience teenage love, teenage romance. So one day, as we were worshiping in the chapel as a school, I was sitting down, and I saw this young girl. And she brought her guitar to the stage, and then she started playing her guitar, and she started singing, and I was like, wow, that girl is talented, and she is kind of pretty. And I had a, what you would call, I had a crush on her. You know, I admired her. But you know, I never had the courage to go approach to her, and I never had the courage to go talk to her. So I let it go. And then comes February 14. You're smiling. Why? February 14. Well, what is February 14 all about? It's Valentine's Day, right? Now, you would think that I had the courage to do something on February 14. At least something on February 14, right, Diamond? Do something on that day. Well, I never had the courage to approach any girls romantically. But that morning, that year, on Valentine's Day, as I walked out of the cafeteria, a friend of mine called me from behind and said, "Hey, Puya, come over here." So I went over there. And a friend of mine gave me this gift, this little box, a box in the shape of a heart. And I said, "Okay, well, that was awkward, you know, there were people around, so I was like, okay, thank you, whatever, you know." So I went back to the dorm. And I opened that box, so that was a special Valentine's Day gift. You can just tell it from the shape, you know, it's a love shape. And I opened it, and inside I found chocolates. Chocolates were very special, especially packed chocolate inside, and some of the chocolates were in a love shape chocolates. And underneath those chocolates was a letter. I took out the letter and I started reading. I won't bore you with the details. And at the bottom of the letter was a name written down. And guess who it was from? It was from the girl who played the guitar and who was able to do special music and who I thought was really talented and really pretty. The point is, while I thought I was the only one who admired her and who thought she was cool, and I thought I was the one who first would have the courage to approach or would demonstrate or would show my affection or my admiration. But before I even knew it, she was the one who did it first, who approached me first, who showed her admiration of me first. You know, Whenever I think about God's love and God's mercy being demonstrated to us while we were still sinners, the story comes to mind. Why? Because the fact of the matter is that the Bible tells us that God demonstrates His own love toward us by sending Jesus, by Christ, dying for us while we were still sinners. Before we ever had any idea of God's love, He had already demonstrated to us. Amen? Before you and I have any idea of divine love, a love that God has, before we ever had any experience of love, God had already loved us with an everlasting love. He first loved us. Oftentimes we like to think that the Bible is about how to find God, and or how sinners can come to God. Well, in some ways that is true, but the more I study the Bible, the more convinced I am that the Bible is not about how sinners can find God, but rather telling us how God has come to seek us, how God has come to search for us. He first loved us. That's our key point number two. The basis of our hope lies in the abundance of God's mercy demonstrated to us in the fact that Christ died for us while we were still sinners. So let's review. What's the key point number one? The basis of our hope lies not in our own perfection or our own righteousness, but key point number two, the basis of our hope lies in the abundance of God's mercy. And key point number three, the basis of our hope lies in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That is what Peter tells us in this text, right? Let's go back to that text, 1 Peter 1, chapter 1, verse 3 to 6. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to His abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope. Through what? Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not fade away. What a blessing to know that our hope lies in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul writes to the Christians in Corinth with this message, and he summarizes it by the fact that Jesus rose again. And this is what Paul is saying here. And if Christ is not risen, so this is saying if, let's just say that Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and your faith is also empty. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that He raised up Christ, whom He did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. See? Let's just say that Christ is not risen. Then we are telling lies, because we're preaching of a risen Savior. We are preaching that God has raised up Christ. But if Christ has not risen, then we are preaching some lies, and our faith is meaningless, and our preaching is meaningless. But he said, for if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. What is Paul saying? He's saying, if our hope is only in this world, then we are the most pitiable people in the world. You see, for people who don't believe in God, at least they get to enjoy the short pleasures of the world, and they even don't care to make money through corruption and unlawful ways. But as Christians, we live by a different standards from God. And God doesn't always promise us sunshine and rainbow in this world. And so, if our hope is only in this world, then we're not really having any advantage over non-Christians if our hope ends in this world. But Paul is saying, this is saying, if, let's just say that Christ is not risen. But the fact of the matter is that Christ has risen. In the same chapter, if we read from verse 3, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3, go in your Bible and mark there from verse 3. Paul said, "For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that He was seen by Cephas, then by the 12. After that He was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present, but some have fallen asleep. After that He was seen by James, then by all the apostles, then the last of all He was seen by me also, as by one who born out of due time." What is Paul saying here? Paul is basically saying in his argument that we are preaching a message of a risen Christ that we witness. This is not some fiction. He is saying here that after Jesus was crucified and after Jesus rose again, this people saw Him, and the disciples saw Him, and 500 people saw Him. They witnessed Him, and more people saw Him, and finally, Christ appeared to me. That's what Paul said. So many people witnessed the resurrected Christ. So this message that Christ is risen again is not some made-up stories. Although many people would want to argue today, saying, "Oh, Christians, you believe in some conspiracy theories that the disciples invented." Yet the question is, how can you fool 500 people all at once? Can 500 people be all delusional in their thinking that they saw a resurrected Jesus? And Paul is saying that while I'm writing this, some of them are still alive. Some of them are still alive who witnessed Jesus after He was resurrected. And most of all, more than the eyewitnesses, we have the proof that the world has been transformed by this message of Jesus. Think about this. Where would you and I be today if Christ has not risen? And the best part of all is that because of Jesus' resurrection, because Christ had risen, our faith is not in vain, and that we no longer are under sins. We have been freed from the power of sin, and there is power in the blood of Jesus Christ, because He defeated sin and death on the cross, and He has invited us to live this lives as Christians. He has called us to a higher standard than the world. And we know that this is a living hope because Christ defeated death. So those are the three key points. Let's review them again. The basis of our hope lies not in our own perfection or our own righteousness, because we have all fallen short of the glory of God. And our own righteousness, are just like filthy rags before God. But God demonstrated His love, and the basis of our hope now lies in the abundance of God's mercy. And key point number 3, the basis of our hope lies in the resurrection of Jesus. And because Jesus defeated death, we can have the confidence that even if we die, God will resurrect us when Jesus comes again. So once again, remember the context in which Peter is saying, writing these. Peter is writing these to Christians who are being persecuted for their faith by the government. People who are losing their homes. People who are losing their jobs and their money. He's telling them, we have a living hope. So friends, this morning, we may be going through challenges because of COVID-19. Some of us may have lost our jobs. Some of us may have lost our homes. Some of us may have lost our family, our loved ones. Some of us may be going through problems after problems of the world. But the good news is that because of Jesus and the fact that he was resurrected from death and he defeated death, we can have the living hope that no matter what happens to us in this world, we can have that living hope. We can have the living hope today. Today. So, if Christ is not risen, our faith is meaningless. If Christ is not risen, we're still held in sins. If Christ is not risen, those who died as Christians have perished. If Christ is not risen, then we do not have a living hope and should be pitied. But the good news is Christ has risen. Amen? Christ has risen, and that is our living hope. That is what Peter is arguing here, a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled. Our inheritance, our possession in this world may be corruptible, and we may lose our possessions, we may lose our homes, our cars. But the good news is God has reserved for us in heaven an inheritance through Jesus Christ that is incorruptible. Nothing in this world can destroy the promise of God. Nothing in this world can corrupt the plans that God has for us. And this is kept by the power of God. We are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation to be revealed in the last time. Ellen G. White, in Review and Herald, February 17, 1885, she wrote these beautiful words. She said, "Look up. Look up. Look up, you who are tired, tempted, and discouraged. Look up. It is ever safe to look up. It is fatal to look down. If you look down, the earth reels and sways beneath you, and nothing is sure." She said, "But heaven above you is calm and steady, and there is divine aid for every climber. The hand of the infinite is reaching over the battlements of heaven to grasp yours in its strong embrace. The mighty helper is nigh to bless, lift up, and to encourage the most erring, the most sinful, if they will look to him by faith. But the sinner must look up. Look up. That is where your hope is. Don't look down." Now, my question for you is, during this past week, how many hours did you spend reading the news or watching the news? How many hours did you spend watching the things of this world? Now, the next logical question is, how many hours or how many minutes did you spend looking up to God, looking up to Jesus through the Word? You see, we spend too much time worrying, and rightly so many times, because we have problems that we face. But we oftentimes, many times, only focus on our problems and the things that we're going through this world. The thing is, if you only watch the news without reading the Bible, you will be depressed. Guaranteed. Because the news is filled, and the news is designed in such a way that we would be bombarded with sad news and tragedies. And in some ways, the situation we live now today is almost like, if the news doesn't contain any accidents or any tragedy, it's almost like it's no longer breaking news or an exciting news. We are conditioned in such a way that we're bombarded with news after news of sad realities of the world. My invitation to you this coming week is, look up. Look up. Don't look down. Let your focus be on God. Are you tired? Are you being tempted? Are you discouraged? The answer is look up. Look up to God through His Word. If you look down, you will only find disappointment. But look up, because nothing is sure in this world. Only God is sure. You may have been relying on the government, but more than ever now, we are seeing that we cannot place our hope in the government. Look up to God. Look up to God. Jeremiah 29, verse 11. Let's conclude with this verse. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Amen? The plans that God has for us. The plans that God has prepared for us is a living hope. It's a living hope. It's a hope not to harm us, but it's a hope that will prosper us and give us a future. So while we go through this world, let's look up. Let's remember that God has given to us a living hope. So, like the early Christians, we may be persecuted. We will be persecuted for our faith. But we have a living hope because of Jesus. We may go through problems in this world, but we have a living hope. That is the difference between a Christian and a non-believer. A Christian knows that we can have a living hope in Jesus. Christ has risen. Christ is coming again, and that is our hope. And may God give us that living hope today. May we live our lives today in the assurance that we have the living hope in God. And no matter what we go through in this world, let's stay faithful. Let's stand firm on our faith because of Jesus. Would you bow your heads with me as I pray for the benediction? Father in heaven, we thank you for the blessings that you have given to us. Most of all, we thank you for Jesus. And it is through Jesus that we come to you this morning. We know that we have direct access to God because Jesus is our high priest. And so, Father God, this morning, we come to you with the burdens of our heart. Some of us may be going through family problems, relationship problems, or financial problems, or challenges that COVID-19 has brought upon us. But Lord, we are learning this morning that regardless of what we're going through, we have living hope. And that living hope is not based on our own righteousness, but rather in the abundance of your mercy shown through Jesus Christ. And the fact that he was resurrected from dead gives us hope beyond this world. We have hope for eternity. So, dear Father, may we live out this calling that you have placed upon our lives. May we stand faithful for you in these last days and stand on that living hope. Walk with us, be with us today, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Elder Lenny has prepared a special music for us before we transition to the Sabbath school. Let's invite Elder Lenny for special music.
Day they pass me by, I can see it in their eyes. Empty people filled with care, headed who knows where. On they go through private pain, living fear to fear. hides their silent cries. Only Jesus hears. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. At the end of broken dreams, He's the open door. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. When will we realize people need the Lord? We are called to take His light to a world where wrong seems right. What could be too great a cost for sharing life with one who's lost? With His love, our hearts can feel all the grief they bear. They must hear the words of life. Only we can share.